What's going on, guys? Welcome back to the Daddy Jeep Garage. I'm sure you guys have heard of the Great American Crawl. Well, I'm actually going to attend the one at AOA in just over a month, and it's time to finally stop adding to my collection of broken axle shafts from my Dana 44. It's time to get the one tons into Daddy Jeep. We don't have a lot of time, so stick with me. We're going to do this fast. We're going to get it done. Picked up a set of 2003 Superduty axles quite a few years ago now, and they came in on a deal. I actually got $0 invested in them, so if you're asking why not step up to the 05s and newers, well, these were free essentially to me. It was just some horse trading that we like to do around here. So I have the axles, and they're still way stronger than a Dana 44, I can tell you that. So for the front axle, due to time and money, we're gonna put that thing on leaf springs. So that's going to be a little different for us, going from the current radius arm setup, going back to a leaf spring in the front. We're going to go ahead and trust the Sterling rear axle and stick with our four-link system back there. But just time and money developing all of the new link mounts, because again, the radius arms only have the two frame mounts, and I think they're going to be longer than I want for a three-link, plus steering, plus all the other stuff to go with three-link. I think the leaf spring front is just going to make my life a whole lot easier. And again, I've got about 5 weeks to get this done, so I'm going to try to keep it as simple as possible, yet still be very capable on the trails, and actually have some axles that I can beat on. So we're going to get right into the Dana 60, the front axle, get started cleaning that thing up, so follow along. This thing's cleaned up and dried. Now we're going to attack it with a needle scaler and try to get some of this scaly rust off this one. The front axle's pretty clean, but this rear one does have some scales. We're going to try to knock it off with a needle scaler. My cousin Jake out here helping tonight. All right, now we need to get this giant obnoxious bracket off. So we're gonna get the plasma out, we're gonna cut this sucker off, and then we have a whole bunch of grinding to do. This, I guess it'd be passenger side leaf spring, lower leaf spring mount all cut off. So now on the driver's side, I'm actually going to cut some of this bracing off so the U-bolt can wrap around from the bottom. I don't want to attach the U-bolts in the conventional manner for a 99-04 Superduty axle. So we're going to do something that I haven't seen done before. So I'm going to see what the plasma will do as far as cutting this cast goes. The next order of business was to wrestle this giant axle up onto my portable fab table. I built these axle brackets, so it actually works pretty good. Gets it a nice height. Now that I have it up here, I was looking at this mount. This is the center pin hole for the leaf spring. I want to offset it as much as possible, so shove this axle forward. There were two existing holes. I just drilled this one out to a half inch, and it allows me to move the spring, or the axle, forward exactly an inch and a half on the center of the spring. So we'll go over to this side. I had the leaf spring in place, did the same on this side, just drilled the casting an inch and a half back to move it back. You can see the center pin is an inch and a half off of center of the axle now, so that means I've pushed that axle forward an inch and a half. So the one thing I'm doing here, which might be a little unconventional, is I'm doing a U-bolt flip. So in a factory configuration on one of these 99-04 Super Duty axles, the U-bolts actually go this direction in front and behind the axle, and then there's a big bracket down on the bottom and the nuts are in the bottom, and that just takes up a lot of ground clearance that I don't want to take away, and it's just rough under there, things to catch. So if I flip it and I come up through, the only thing on the bottom is this little bit of the 9/16 U-bolt, and it's very smooth. It's going to slide over the rocks nicely. So I need to fabricate a plate on top, and these U-bolts may get trimmed slightly, but not very much. They should be about the right length. And again, that's really smooths out the bottom, and I think it's just a better way to mount leaf springs. So with the modifications to the casting, I figured out that I needed 4 1/8 for a U-bolt, and my local Napa that bent the bolts for me, the biggest die they have is a 4-inch, so they went ahead and bent these at 4. I thought I'd have to modify them a bit, but they actually go over the casting just fine, so they're going to work out great. So the driver's side that go over the casting are both 4-inch, and the passer side U-bolts are both 3.5 to go over just the tube diameter itself. So part of building an axle for a rock crawler is installing a locker. So of course we're going to install one of these Torq lockers. This is for the Dana 60 Super Duty axle. So this is a lunchbox style locker that replaces the spider gears. And these things are virtually unbreakable, super easy to install, and of course, American made. So in order to install a locker in this axle, we have to pull the unit bearings, pull the axle shafts so we can separate them from the spider gears. Then we can get rid of those spider gears and install this Torq locker. So the four bolts that hold the unit bearing in are 21 millimeter. They're a little hard to get to. My axle stand might be in the way of this one. Go. I tell you, these vacuum seals are a pain in the butt to get released. Once you get them out of there, they slide right out, but it's a rubber ring that's pressed into the hub, and they like to stay in there. They've been in there a long time, so now that we have that free, we'll go ahead and pull this shaft out of here. And rinse and repeat on the other side. Okay, now that the hubs and axle shafts are both gone, now we can go ahead and pull this diff cover and start pulling spider gears out. There we go. Hey, there wasn't a ton of fluid in there. There's no obvious signs of wear. There's not chunks in the bottom, so that's always a good sign. The gears don't look like they're overly worn. All right, let's get this carrier ripped out of here. I need to find a punch that I can drive that pin out of there with. Okay, so now that we've got the roll pin knocked out of here, all we have to do now is push out this cross pin, which pops right out of there. Set that aside. And then we get these spider gears wrestled out of here. So there are shims on these spider gears. I think we have to reuse those. We did on the the last one of these axles I did. So we're gonna put our side gears in first. We're gonna put this shim back on as it came out. We'll kind of balance that one there. This one, the shim stayed, so we can stick that back in there. Okay, that was it. I just needed to go one piece at a time instead of trying to shove that whole thing in there together. So now, everything's in there, now we just need to rotate it so we can install our springs. So I'm going to go ahead and stick a big screwdriver in here just to hold that apart as much as I can. Give me a little bit more room to work these springs in here. Get my spring pocket lined up. And then once we get it in there, we can just kind of push it down. It'll snap into place once it's seated all the way down there. Around to the other side and rinse and repeat. That's really all there is to it. So now we need to line up our cross pin hole with the cross pin holes in the carrier. We can stick the cross pin back in. So again, the cross pin has a hollow hole, so we have to line that up with where that roll pin goes through. So you want to pay attention to that when you work this back in there. There it is. So before I go ahead and install that cross pin, I want to just look at the directions real quick. Make sure I didn't miss something. I know there is a tolerance you need to measure on this. I believe it's the spacing between the two pieces of the, let me show you. I believe the tolerance needs measured between these two pieces, this gap. There is a tolerance there. Of course, we can't read instructions without the old band glasses. Check the center gap measurement. Use your caliper or feeler gauges. Measure the gap between the two cam gears with the locker teeth engaged. Center gap spacing needs to be between 145 and 175. So, I'm going to grab some calipers. So, with my calipers, and it does note that the make sure the teeth are engaged top and bottom. So, my measurement is 164. That is most certainly between 145 and 175. So this install is done, aside from driving in that roll pin again. Assuming I've kept it lined up. But installing a Torq Locker is just that simple. It's amazing how easy it is to get some good traction in your front axle. My roll pin is not lined up, but I can reach in there with an awl. Just do a little bit of rotating, get that lined right back up. Drop my roll pin in there, carefully get it started. You hear that sound, that means it's stopped. There is a stop in there, so you can't go too far. So make sure you drive that roll pin down until it stops. There we go. Oh boy. Now we're getting it. So again, we're lining up our marks, our horizontal mark on this side, the vertical mark on this side. So just get them snug for now. We're gonna go ahead and torque them to spec. All right, the bearing caps get torqued to 85 foot-pounds. So that is that. This Torq Locker is installed. Super simple. All we have to do is put some RTV around the diff cover, slap the diff cover back on, fill it back up with oil. All right, guys, that's just it. It's that simple to get traction in your front axle. So this Torq Locker is super easy to install. Doesn't take any special fluids. Just put your diff cover back on, put normal fluid back in it. It's gonna click a little bit. That's just the habits of a mechanical locker. Instructions do say to use a little heavier oil to minimize the clicking, but you know, if you're a real wheeler, you don't care if your front axle's clicking. And the last thing to make sure you do is put your Torq Locker stickers on your vehicle. Now we've got traction. Okay, we have some repurposed 3/8 inch plate that a buddy brought home from work. We're gonna use this to make some spring plates. So I went ahead and clamped the straight edge on there. Let's take this cut 55 and see how it does. Yes, heavy, a lot of cutting. We better wear gloves, both of them. Clean cut. Some places are better than others, but I'm more than happy with that cut. Like that. I tell you, if you haven't made the investment on a plasma cutter yet and you do metalworking at all, you really need to do it. I mean, this cut 55, I think this cut 55 we're using, yes, welder cut 55, it's less than $300 and it is absolutely a game changer. How long would it have taken me to cut all four sides of 3/8 plate with a cutoff wheel? I mean, I'd have been here for days. This took me about 20 minutes to cut four sides 3/8 plate for two different spring plates. Just a great tool, worth the investment. Save your pennies and get yourself one. So now that we've got the plates cut, we gotta get the edges ground, bevel some corners, and poke some holes, and we'll have some spring plates. I guess I didn't get any footage of me making this axle pretty, but we got it all cleaned up. We put some paint on it. Of course, we had to put some green on there. Running the factory diff cover for now, just because time and money, that's where we're at. So. This axle is done, but now it's not. So I ended up picking up a great deal on a set of 456 gears. All the stuff, I got master rebuild kits, gaskets, oil, everything with a great deal. So now I have to pull this back apart. We're gonna go ahead and re-gear this to 456, but that won't be in this video. That'll be a couple videos from now, I suppose. So thanks for watching, guys. I'm well on my way on the Sterling 10.5 build, so make sure to stay tuned. We're going to have another video out real soon on that. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.